All things bright and beautiful. with profound joy, we come into the presence of Jesus. How good it is to gather as this community to refresh our souls.
Blessed are those who enter the houses of God. We praise God with our worship and with the lives we lead.
As church, we welcome both friend and stranger, because all are loved by Christ. We practice extravagant welcome in His name.
We open our hearts to the love of God. We offer the work of our hands to minister with compassion and charity.
Let us open our minds to new understandings. Let us choose to follow Jesus, who guides us with words of eternal life.
Surely God will equip us for the work of discipleship. We will be ambassadors for Christ wherever God leads us to go.
And now, coming together as this congregation in person, and also those joining us via Zoom, our unison prayer. We gather as a worshiping congregation, trusting you, O God, to give us all that we need in life. As you provide for the birds of the air, you also supply life's necessities for us to share. We give you thanks, God of majesty and mercy, for the beauty and the bounty of the earth, and for the vision of the day, when sharing by all will mean scarcity for none. We choose to respond to your promises by identifying ourselves as your people, as those who seek to be guided by your holy word. We gather to remember and reclaim your covenant with us. We gather to be equipped for the task you entrust to us as individual Christians and as the community of this church. We pray for the strength to do what you have entrusted to us as disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen. Jacob and Zipporah. cat's in a unicorn. All right. He really likes that piano. All right. Hello there. Nice to see you again. So I never know how this is going to work out, but we'll try, okay? So today in that reading, we talked about putting on stuff that protects us, okay? Like my shoes. Like if we walked outside and I was walking across the driveway and there was like a little rock or something and I didn't have my shoes on and I stepped in the rock, it would hurt. So my shoes protect me. When it gets a little bit colder, I got my clothes on, and if it gets cold, you know, the clothes help me to stay warm. They protect me. If it gets really cold in the winter, I put a hat on, and the hat keeps me warm and protects me from like really cold rain or snow or something like that. And Jesus today says that he wants us to put on like all that kind of protection, that spiritual protection, to keep us safe and strong. And he says that when you're not strong enough, he says you trust that God is strong enough. Okay, so one of the reasons that we come to church, one of the reasons that we go to Sunday school, is to help us trust that when we need, God is always there to hold us, protect us, and guide us. Okay, can you remember that for me today? That God is always there to hold us, protect us, and guide us? Yeah? That went over really well. All right, thank you for being such good kids. Thank you, thank you. All right. All right. Okay. Yeah, okay. All right. No, yeah, and you're a princess too today, Jay. Look at your, our teacher's a princess. Oh, very nice, very nice. Okay. And today's special music is from Anthony, and it is called Rainbow.
Stop blowing, but you're stuck out in the always been a rainbow hanging over your head. It'll all be alright.
Thanks, Anthony. That was beautiful. Let me just share a quick story about the last church, Hatfield, that I was at. The same song was sung by a woman from that congregation, and she is extremely nervous about singing, and I saw Anthony really just kind of gently being there for her, and it was beautiful. But she actually went to the cemetery directly behind the church, and she went to the cemetery before the service to talk to her brother who died a while back. Her brother is the one who told her to take chances in life, so she went out to the cemetery and said, "I'm doing this, you better be there for me." And so she sang that song, and in her words, it's a trauma for her to get up and to sing, especially a solo, but she did a beautiful job. And that idea about, you know, pushing your envelope and trusting that this is a safe community that you can do those kind of things in, I just found that really heartening today. And the words of that song are beautiful, and that experience was just beautiful. Not to say Anthony's wasn't beautiful, so we're glad to have him back. But that was very special, so thank you. Now it's time for us to share in our prayers. And we've got to continue to pray for Ukraine and Russia. It's been 3 years now, and I just pray that at some point this human logic, that this is the way to move forward, it gives way to the logic of God, that we have to find ways to live together. And so I hope that there is peace there. We also pray for peace in the Middle East, the war with Hamas and Israel, the war with Israel and Hezbollah, the war with Israel and Iran. We also pray there that these persistent struggles in that one special place in our world, they can find a way to live together somehow and turn to God for that prayer. We also continue to pray for our nation as we face the reality of persistent and institutional racism. And also, we do have one of our Bible study members. We've been praying for a young boy that is part of his family through school. His name is Cameron, and he's undergoing treatments for cancer. So we pray for that young person. And we also want to add Anthony's dad to our prayer, this Tony Tracia, that he may have a full and speedy recovery. And the last thing I want to say before I turn it over to you is we do have Frank Marchand on our yellow sheet. I just walked into church this morning, and Irene let me know that Frank passed away last night. And so a lot of us know Frank, a lot of us love Frank. He's put up a heroic battle against cancer, but he has now been called to his heavenly reward. And so when we do mention Frank Marchand on our yellow sheet, it's not for health any longer or for comfort. It is during his time with hospice. It's now that he may enjoy the presence of God in heaven. So we'll just keep that in mind when we hit Frank on the yellow sheet. Any joys, celebrations, concerns that anybody would like to offer here? Yes?
I'd like to ask for safe travel prayers for Frank. He's heading out to Italy tomorrow for 2 weeks to visit with his family.
Wonderful. All right. But your husband has a safe trip to Italy. Yes, Kathy?
Just a prayer for my brother-in-law, who will be undergoing cancer treatments shortly for throat cancer.
Okay, prayers for your brother-in-law. I see him. Yes.
Prayers for actually two friends. One friend who has multiple health issues, and her son is now going through some difficulties with his marriage. And then for the other friend who is showing signs of early onset cancer.
All right, Reverend Linda, we'll keep that in our thoughts and prayers as well.
And my safe home from Scotland.
And William says he's arrived safely from Scotland.
All right.
And I'm joining you in worship this morning, like I did last week over there. I'm joining you back at home, so.
All right. And we have a birthday up here at the front with Pam, and today is the actual day of her birthday, so happy birthday, Pam. Yeah, happy birthday.
Thank you.
any other joy, celebrations, concerns before we hit the yellow sheet? Okay, let us offer our prayers for, we're just saying first names, prayers for Alan, Alice, Amy, and Tom, Angie, and Tony and family, Art, Bill, Bonnie, Chris and family, Cheryl, Cindy, Doreen, Edna, Frank, Fred, Grayson, Jeff, Jim, John, Kathy, Leslie, Liz, Lynn, Marsha, Mary Jane, and Joe, Michelle, Mike, Pauline, Richard, Rick, Sandra, and John, Steve, Stephen, Virginia, and Richard, Wink, the family of Pauline Todd, victims of violence and natural disasters anywhere in the world, and we pray for peace on earth. And then we now turn inward for just a few moments to offer our silent prayers to God. They're just as heard in heaven. These are prayers we choose not to say out loud. So just a few moments of silence. Holy One of God, sent to live among us in faithfulness to God's loving intention for all of humanity, lead our journey toward the truth that is eternal. When we cannot see the way forward toward that eternal truth, come closer to us and guide us by the hand. When our faith is weakened, protect us with the armor of God. Help us to grow and trust in your way rather than always in our ways. Lead us to live in harmony with others and all of God's good creation. Hear the prayers that we share with you today, those both spoken and silent, answering them as you alone know best. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And let us now join together in sharing the prayer that Jesus gave to all of his followers, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. now be placed in your sanctuary as a symbol of our love for you and for all others. We've already heard that first passage of today's worship about put on the armor of God. Sometimes it says in that passage that we need to be strong, we need to trust in the strength that God gives us, the strength that is God. And we here as church, that's one of the reasons we come together as community, to feel strengthened by God by coming here and sharing in each other's prayers, each other's lives, and in this sanctuary. So we pray that all of us may become stronger in God, and we offer our thanks to you for these continuing donations, and we ask God to bless these offerings so that they continue to be a place where people in this world that can be so exhausting and so draining with our constant animosity, our constant battles and hatreds, that we may come to places like this, actual sanctuaries in the world, to be strengthened by God. This we ask in his name. Amen. Our reflecting hymn this morning is from Blue Hymn number 496, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms.
Jesus asked the 12, "Do you also wish to go away?"
And Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and to know that you are the Holy One of God." May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts together be accepted to you, O Lord, our Rock and our Redeemer. So this, I promise, this is my last vacation story. I won't torment you as a captive audience with any more vacation stories after this. So we went to Portugal, and it was about, our, I think it was our third and last day in the city of Porto. And we're in Porto, and we've been walking around for 3 days, basically in the same old part of the city, kind of had a feel for the city, kind of knew how to get around. And so it's evening, and two dads, we heard that they were going to go do some more shopping. I mean, there's no tiles left in Portugal. We came home with all the tiles in Portugal. So they said, more shopping. And so the two dads, we said, well, we're going to go back to the house we rented. As soon as the two dads said, we're going to go back to the house, immediately there was concern that we would get lost. The four daughters who were in their 20s, they all said, I think they started, you know, doing that short straw thing, who would have to leave shopping and go walk the dads back to the house and all that. We said, no, we'll be fine, we can get our way there, don't you worry. And so as we're walking away, afterwards, we got back to the house eventually, my daughter Kristen showed me a video. She actually took a video of me and the other dad, Keith, walking away, because I really thought she would never see us again. So she had this as her last remembrance as we walked away. But we were really sure that we could get to that house. And was really sure that we got lost on the way to the house. And so as we're going to the house, we don't know where we're going. We're wandering this way and that. And J.R.R. Tolkien once wrote that all who wander are not lost. We were really lost. So we didn't know where we were going. So we're walking around out there. And, you know, sometimes, even when you're like two dads, you know, that proverbial idea of the father who never stopped to ask for directions? Well, that was us. We just took off and we were absolutely sure we could get back. We couldn't. So when you have that attitude like two dads who just think that they know where they're going, they can get you there, well, sometimes I think we have to be humble enough to actually let somebody take us by the hand and lead us. And that's what today's gospel is all about. Sometimes when we don't know how to move forward in the faith, when we face really deep questions, questions that, you know, the logic and the normalcy of faith, they just don't seem to answer, that's when we got to trust that Jesus will take us by the hand. And the sad thing about today's gospel is that somehow they weren't able to trust and they left. So that ties in with this idea that, you know, that trust is something that faith needs to rely upon when all the other aspects of faith aren't strong. And as I mentioned at the beginning of the service, I really think that faith makes sense. I really think that there is knowledge that backs up faith. I really think that, you know, the 2,000 years of Christian history, it speaks to something deep within us, that somehow that carpenter from Nazareth, there's something more to his life than the carpenter of Nazareth. And it's not because I just trust what people are telling me about the carpenter of Nazareth from 2,000 years ago. I feel it, and I hope you feel it as well. And I hope when you come to church, maybe that feeling gets a little bit stronger, gets refreshed. You put on the armor of God. Because at some point, faith doesn't make sense. We all run into points in our lives where that question, why, is just too big. And we wonder if Jesus is enough of an answer. I think everyone has experienced that. I know clergy have experienced that, and I imagine you do too. That question of why. And so some of the people in the story called disciples of Jesus, they faced that question of why. And because they didn't have trust that was strong enough in their faith, they walked away. And that's a message that we need to really take seriously, because as you know, a lot of people have walked away from church. A lot of people have walked away from the Christian faith. And maybe it's because we haven't given them the chance and the deepness to build trust into faith. And so I think what we do right now, I do not, and I hate the idea of treating church as an obligation. That you come here so you get like a little check mark up in God's heavenly notebook that says, oh, you were in church on August 25th. Oh, 4 months till Christmas. So, well, you know, on August 25th, you were in church. I don't think that's the way God works. And I don't think it's like if you don't go to church, it's going to be a black mark against you. I think we come here because this is a place where we get refreshed and we need this. This is our oasis where we can go out in the rest of the week This is a place that kind of builds and strengthens us as Christians, as people of faith. And the intimacy of this congregation, I think that's important as well, because it's a wonderful thing to be able to trust in God. It's a wonderful thing to be able to trust in each other. So this is a safe place for us. This is, like I mentioned, that woman from Hathor that could come, and her word was trauma to sing. It's a safe place where like a little child can come up and plop down on a couple of keys on the keyboard. It's a safe place. We're here for each other. And so I think that's extremely important because, again, there are going to be why moments in our lives that faith is not strong enough to answer without trust. So there's this children's story about Caleb. It's a Christmas story. And this little character, he has to make his way up through the branches of a Christmas tree because he feels that at the top of the Christmas tree, that there's purpose to his journey. There's answers at the top of the Christmas tree. And so there's all these different stories of what Caleb has to endure to start making his way up to the top of the Christmas tree. And as he's walking along in this path, all of a sudden he comes to a point, if he stepped one more foot, he would have fallen into this chasm, into the darkness below. And so Caleb gets to that point, he wobbles on the edge of that cliff, and Caleb is now dumbfounded. You know, he felt that there was a reason for him to be on this path, and now all of a sudden the path is stopped. And so Caleb doesn't know what to do. And Caleb thinks that he can see on the other side of this gap that there maybe the path continues, but he can't be sure. And so Caleb has to trust in God. So he's got to trust that if I run far enough back, and if I run and try to jump over this gap, that there'll be something on the other side that will take me in and I can continue on the path. He has to trust that there's a way forward. He has to trust that there's a purpose to his journey. And so Caleb does that. He runs and he makes that leap of faith, which Kierkegaard talked about, this leap of faith, so that sometimes when we have those questions and we don't have answers from our normal, ordinary, Sunday morning kind of faith, sometimes we just gotta trust. Take that leap of faith. We got to do something that just hold my hand, Jesus, and take me forward because I don't know the way to go. And sometimes that can only be done when we do the hard work of building our faith, like on Sunday mornings, or by reading the Bible, or by prayer. And I don't mean prayer that somebody else writes for us. I mean prayer from the heart. So now that it's summer, I take my dog out as soon as I get up. So I get up, I dress, and off I go. So I'm off at like 6:15, 6:20 in the morning. I don't do that the rest of the year. When it starts to get cold and dark, I like my bed. But in the summertime, I can go out at 6:15 in the morning with my beeves. So we're walking, and we always see this one guy. He's a young guy, really a friendly guy, wonderful guy. And so I'm walking by, and he's on this porch, and I would often just kind of wave and say hi. We'd have a little conversation sometimes. But I've learned in the morning, don't say hi. Because he's on his porch, and I didn't know if he was sleeping or whatever, but I talked to him later, and he's meditating. So he's on his porch in the morning, 6-something in the morning, looking out in the field, you know, and it's a little bit cooler than the rest of the day, and he's sitting there, and he's meditating. And he says it gives him the calmness for the rest of the day, that the rest of the day can go better because of what he does in the morning. So that turning inward, that meditation that he begins his day with, as Christians, do we do the same thing? Do we really take time on a busy Tuesday, on a busy Thursday, to start our day by not just saying Our Father, who art, but I mean to talk to God? Do we really take the time to build that intimacy of our faith so that as we get into a Monday meeting that we don't want to do, that when we have Tuesdays just filled up on the calendar from morning till night, do we make time so that we can talk to God? This young guy, out there meditating on his porch, just getting ready for the day because that's how he prepares himself. Do we as Christians, do we take time to meditate with God and build that intimacy that helps us go along? Think about what the gospel says. Jesus is in the Capernaum synagogue. That's his adopted hometown. So this is not Jesus the outcast. This is not Jesus the one who's being accosted by the Pharisees and the scribes. This is Jesus who is now accepted as a rabbi. This is Jesus who is teaching other fellow people in Capernaum the ways of God, and they're accepting him. They're calling him a rabbi. They've seen his miracles. They're saying this is a wonder worker empowered by God. And so Jesus has got this synagogue setting, and his disciples are in the synagogue. Not just the 12, but disciples are in the synagogue. They respect him. Other gospels talk about Capernaum as like this like honeymoon period for Jesus, where it is really going super well, and when Jesus decides to leave, the disciples say, no, let's stay here. This is wonderful. So Jesus is in that Capernaum synagogue, and all of his disciples are there. They're listening to him. They think he's talking about God, but all of a sudden today he starts to talk about me, Jesus of Nazareth, the one who's come to you from John the Baptist. I'm the one who's hanging out with fishermen and tax collectors. This is me, and I want to tell you, eat my body and drink my blood. And as soon as the people in that Capernaum synagogue hear, eat my body and drink my blood, they say, this is hard to accept. Who can follow this? And so when Jesus stops talking about God and starts talking about me, eat my body and drink my blood, they say, because of this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went with Jesus. So they were disciples. They were followers of Jesus. They were people in church. And all of a sudden, Jesus said something that they on their own could not process, that they on their own could not understand, that they on their own would not follow, and so they had to backtrack. They had to go back to where they were, and they had to leave Jesus. And so the message is not just about a Capernaum synagogue 2,000 years ago. The message is for people of faith, sometimes we encounter things in the life of Jesus, sometimes in the life of the church, sometimes in our own spirituality, where we can't figure it out. We just got a big question mark. We have just why written in capital letters. And that's when we have to have a faith that is strong enough that we have this reservoir of trust. So that when things are just beyond what we can understand, when we don't know the way forward, we can feel that hand of Jesus reaching out to us and saying, follow me. That truly is a blessing. That's a gift. That's that leap of faith. When we don't know how to go forward, take that leap of faith anyway. So, that eat my body, drink my blood, the imagery is kind of hard to process, especially if you're hearing it for the first time. But basically, it's like the food that enters into our body. If you've had breakfast this morning, that food is inseparable from who you are. It is a part of you. And Jesus says, I'm that food that comes into you. Abide in me, and they will abide. I'll abide in them, and they will abide in me. Christ and Christian, we become like this. That's the definition of trust. So when everybody else leaves, Jesus turns to the 12 and says, are you also going to go? And that question is in the Bible because it's meant for everybody who's reading the Bible. It's meant for people in Sunderland on August 25th, 2024. Are you also going to leave? And they say, where else can we go? You have the words of life. And so that's what we need to try to find. Is that kind of trust when we don't know the way forward, when we don't know the answers, when we have a lot of questions, a lot of whys, we need to be like Peter and say, we've got to go with you. We trust that you have the words of life. So may our time together as church, may your own time and privacy of the prayers that you offer, reading the Bible, meditating, whatever, may that strengthen your faith, that you have that trust. So when we face questions and difficulties, not certain on the way forward, we can still trust that Jesus is our way. And for these things we pray in his name, amen. Mm-hmm. And our hymn of closing today is Red Hymn number 263, Christ Has Made the Sure Foundation.
Thank you.
as I mentioned, remember that in 2 weeks, church is at 9:30, not the usual 11. And also we have, on that same day, we have the anti-Semitism talk next door from 3 to 5. And also, we'll soon be talking more about the Crop Hunger Walk. That will be on October 6th. So we're getting back into that fall schedule. So let's take that as a blessing and a place to build our intimacy and trust with God. Let us now offer our benediction response and then go our separate ways as we carry God out into the world. Let us take this prayerful spirit of worship into the everyday world. God will listen and respond to our prayers and will work with us to continue the ministry of Jesus. We have the good news to share with a world that is in desperate need of its healing and guidance. So let us do our part to extend God's reign. Let us be open to the Spirit's promptings so that we can know Jesus better, share him with others, and continue his work. So let us now go forth to love and serve the Lord in all that we do, among all whom we may meet. Amen.
Thank you, Kathy.
Okay, Lisa and Will, have a good day.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, take care.
Yeah.
All right, Lisa.